Let's just get started. Good afternoon. I'm David Uy, Executive Director of the Chinese American Museum. If you're familiar with our project, we are a new museum in development focusing on the history, culture, and contributions of Chinese Americans. Our museum is in downtown Washington, D.C., and it's the first and only museum of its kind in our nation's capital. So we hope that you get to know our project by visiting us in the future when it's safe or through programs like it's really fun seeing so many familiar faces, and I'll just be first to say that we really miss you and we look forward to getting together in person very soon. So today we are so pleased to host a conversation with Christopher Tin, two-time Grammy Award-winning composer of some of the most inspirational music of our time. Christopher is from Palo Alto, California, went to Stanford, was a Fulbright scholar at the Royal College of Music in London, and true to his Silicon Valley roots, his work has crossed paths numerous times with the video game industry, and the score that he composed for the Civilization game series became the first video game theme to win a Grammy. His works such as Baba Yetu and Sogno de Volare have really transcended the video game world and have touched and moved people across wide audiences. So Christopher is about to release his latest album, Shiver the Sky, this Friday, August 21st, and we'll show some information at the end of the event on how you can connect to his new album. Joining us to lead a conversation about Christopher Tin's journey work is Jenny Bilfield, President and CEO of Washington Performing Arts since 2013. Jenny is a composer herself and graduated from the University of Pennsylvania with a BA in music. She has been acknowledged with a number of awards for her many contributions to the arts, including the American Society of Composers, Authors, and Publishers Adventuresome Programming Award. So to start our session, we're gonna show a brief trailer for Shiver the Sky. It's about 3.5 minutes long, and we'll turn it over to Jenny and Christopher.
To Shiver the Sky is an album about flight. It tells the story of humanity's quest to break the bonds of Earth, challenge the heavens, and claim our rightful place among the stars. It's the story of men and women who strapped on helmets and boots just to leave their footprints on new lands. But it's also the tale of those who made their journeys possible, like the astronomers who drew maps of the stars, and the artists who drew inspiration from them. Or the American president who committed his country towards humanity's single greatest achievement. This is a story of courage. The courage to be the first woman to fly solo across the Atlantic, and to give wings to women everywhere. Or the courage to climb aboard a rocket and be the first man launched across the threshold of space. But it's also a story of failure, where the soaring inventions of great men and women plummet to Earth in fiery wreckage. It's also a story of death. One where airplanes built to soar among the clouds are used instead for dropping bombs. Or in our darkest moments, become the bombs themselves. Humans are resilient, and the call of the sky will not be denied. And each time we find ourselves deep in that darkest night, the dream of flight beckons us to emerge from the darkness and to re-behold the stars. This is the story of flight, performed by some of the greatest musicians in the world, and using the words of 11 of history's pioneers, stargazers and storytellers, scientists and statesmen, men and women who freed us from the shackles of gravity and stretched the limits of our imagination. This is a tale that spans centuries and continents. A tale of shared human accomplishment like none other. It's the story of our ascent to magnificence. A testament to the power of the spirit and the greatest adventure on which humankind has ever embarked.
Excellent. So I turn it over to Jenny Bilfield and Christopher Tin.
Thank you. You know, I always feel a little bit choked up when I watch that that advance reel, because the music and the work, the thought, the care that went into it, the aspirations are so stunning and moving and have an even greater impact, I think, now that we've been so confined, but nonetheless, aspiring to greater things and reflecting on history and seeing how we propel forward. Thank you, David, so much. Thank you to the museum and to Penny Yao for putting this together and all of you for being here today. I'm Jenny Bilfield, President and CEO of Washington Performing Arts. We're an arts presenter and producer based in our nation's capital of Washington, D.C. And for several years, we've been working with Chris to bring together a live performance of To Shiver the Sky, to bring it to DC. He and I have been friends for about 15 years. And this was the project that really excited both of us in terms of connecting some very important local and national history with an American narrative. The live performance was originally slated for May, so a couple months ago, and then it was rescheduled for August. And then because we are still not able to gather the forces necessary to perform this work live, because it is epic, as you've seen from some of the clips, but we wouldn't be deterred by the pandemic, we put our heads together to re-engineer some key elements, and specifically the live performance part. I'm so thrilled that the museum has invited us and organized and hosted this preview conversation. As David touched upon a little bit, there really is a fascinating arc to Christopher Tin's creative journey and the deeply moving inspiration behind the oratorio. Today we're going to talk about both the inspiration slash Christopher Tin and the work itself. And I hope that this will inspire you to do several things. First, purchase the album when it's released on August 21st by Decca. And also on August 29th to join all of us, Washington Performing Arts hosted, online August 29th for an inside look at To Shiver the Sky, featuring a movement, the movement Courage, from the work with superstar soprano Danielle Denise, National Treasures of the U.S. Air Force Band, Colonel Don Schofield, conductor commander, and Christopher Tin conducting, complete with interviews with Danielle Denise, Dr. Michelle Thaler from NASA, the Goddard Arts Space Center, and Charlie Blackwell Thompson, the launch director from the Kennedy Space Center. And so for more information, please go to the Washington Performing Arts website. We'll be sure that you you have that link. So at this moment when globally we're at our most confined and hyperlocal, we're yet connected online beyond our physical space and limitations. And To Shiver the Sky takes us even further beyond our physical space. For those who are joining right now, to describe it from Chris's words, To Shiver the Sky is an oratorio about the history of flight and mankind's quest to conquer the heavens. told through the words of 11 of our greatest astronomers, inventors, visionaries, and pilots. It charts our relentless need to explore the universe, defy our earthly bonds, reach for the face of God, and ultimately claim our place among the stars. It is sung in English, Latin, Italian, German, French, Polish, Russian, and Sanskrit. So we will get to this epic work in a few moments, but first I have a few questions for Chris about his early years. Everybody is, I think, always interested when somebody reaches a level of prominence, how an artist gets started. So Chris, you've received extensive and impressive training, and your music is so well known. It's been performed in concert halls, in stadia worldwide, at important ceremonial occasions, on TV, and regularly comes into our homes through the explosively popular video games that you have scored, including Civilization IV. Now, these are pretty grand platforms, and I wonder if you could say a few words about your first musical steps. What drew you to music, and then how did you know that you wanted to study, create, and make music your profession?
I think, like any good young Asian American, I learned an instrument from a very early age. I was a pianist growing up. And I mean, I it was one of these things where in the early years, like anyone else kind of starting out, you just sort of get forced into it. But over time, as you get familiar with the art form and as your skills improve, you learn to really embrace it and love it, right? And so that love of music caught on pretty early for me, but it extended well beyond just playing pieces. It actually, I wanted to know how music works. And the key to unlocking that question is the study of music theory, understanding how chords work, harmonies, harmonic progression, structure, form, all of these elements. It became the foundation for a lifelong study of the secrets and intricacies of music and how it's put together. I think early on, my imagination was captured more on the theatrical side of music. I was very into things like musical theater early on. That's kind of what gave me my first taste of actually writing music. I wrote my own musical at the age of, I guess I was 17 at the time, and I put it on in our high school with my friends. You know, we kind of like got some kids from the drama department and some kids from the band program, and we staged this little musical. And it really gave me a taste for what it's like to conceive a large scale project and then carry it all the way through to fruition. And that became a lifelong obsession of mine. Over the decades, my resources and my vision have gotten grander and grander to almost comical levels, such as To Shiver the Sky. I'm no longer producing things, you know, in the band room of my high school. Now we're doing it on bigger stages. Ideally, we would have done it at the Anthem earlier this year, but, you know, here we are now. You know, I think at the very early age, I just kind of caught the bug. And like all other musicians who went into it professionally, it just becomes a lifelong obsession of yours.
Thank you. I mean, as you're speaking about your early studies, I wonder too, since you have such a rich palette, you're obviously very skilled with the technology around you in order to realize your vision, but you work with live musicians regularly. And what were some of the formative composers and works that helped build the Christopher Tin sound palette?
It's so varied. That's the thing. I mean, I'm very much very inclusive when it comes to music. And I'm maybe a little bit outside of sort of like the academia in that I am very much embracing of things like musical theater and jazz and rock and pop and electronic music even. I mean, I feel like every genre of music out there has something to offer that you can learn from. And ultimately as a composer, your own creative voice is gonna come out of the way you synthesize all of these disparate elements. So when I write pieces like To Shiver the Sky, yes, there's a very strong classical backbone to it, but there are also elements of, you know, there's maybe a touch of like a little West Side Story influence from the musical theater world, or maybe there's a touch of jazz influence in this one choral piece. There's all these little elements that sort of come together, that fuse together to form my sound. And I think the way that a young composer should try to find their voice is by synthesizing a lot of different elements. So that's how I've always chosen to embrace, you know, the musical world around me.
Yeah. So I know that we have some creative artists and friends and family of and teachers of creative artists viewing today. And, you know, people don't necessarily know the full spectrum of what's possible within field of music. You know, often kids start out with a great capacity, and then it's presumed that either they join an ensemble, such as an orchestra or a band, or start their own rock band. But the ways in which you have expanded your own reach and work, I think could be really interesting to hear. What are the ways that that musicians can sort of create a path for themselves, the different ways that you've seen from your vantage point, having worked with and studied within a conservatory to working within a very commercial environment as well? I think it would be interesting for people to hear about those different paths that are possible.
Well, I think, you know, over the course of the last 20 years, which is sort of the you know, the time in which I've been active professionally, you know, the number of opportunities out there have just exploded exponentially, right? I mean, there is no shortage of avenues to create music and to get it out there in the world. I mean, the challenge is, in a way, to cut through the noise, right? But there's no shortage of, you know, networks, new networks popping up, like Quibi, and Apple Plus and Disney Plus. I mean, there's a lot of media out there now churning out content, all of which needs music. There's a lot of, you know, live performance is still very much, well, it was until the pandemic, very live and active world to engage in. I think what's particularly exciting to me in the last few years is that the barriers between all these worlds have broken down somewhat. I think there is no longer sort of an allergic reaction from a major symphony orchestra to programming a night of movie music, for example. You know, you see a lot of major orchestras playing on soundtracks, for example. I think what's great about this is that there's no longer a need to try to keep your serious composing life separate from your commercial composing life. And what I think I've been successful at doing thus far, is to find a way to bridge those, to use the successes that I've had, for example, in the media world to find a niche for myself in the concert composing world, or vice versa, to find, you know, leverage the, you know, maybe the reviews I've gotten for my song cycles and oratorios into appealing to, you know, film directors and game developers, right? So I think, you know, this cross-fertilization between the commercial and the artistic, it's now beginning to be a thing that I think young artists can actually look to embrace and not shy away from.
Yeah, it's an interesting point, because I think you're right, it is more porous, and it's also, we're much more of a visual society. So when you complement the visual and the musical, there's a great deal of engagement that's possible in the way people consume the arts, as much through the eyes as the ears. So it's an exciting moment for your work to flourish. You know, as I was listening to your music a couple months ago, I was thinking that, you know, not every composer can flex to work as adeptly as you do within the world of film scoring and video games, because the dominance of music in a pure concert setting versus the nesting of visual and musical bring together this notion of collaboration and pairings versus complete control and agency. And I was wondering, you know, how did you, apart from the early experience in writing a musical and those larger scale performances, how did you sort of move into this world? I seem to remember actually when you spoke at an event we that the Singapore Embassy hosted with us back in January here in Washington, D.C. You shared a story of when you and your wife put together a dynamic pitch for a project in L.A. So I wonder if you could say a little bit about that, because I think those were some of the early moorings of that leap in.
You know, I that project that you're talking about in particular is we put together a pitch for Crazy Rich Asians.
That's right.
And that was an exciting little project. My wife, by the way, she's a graphic designer, and we actually share a studio space. So we have a big sort of warehouse facility. Half of it is my side with my recording studio, you know, upstairs and downstairs. Half of it is her design studio. So our collaboration, you know, it's a 24/7 thing. You know, either we're here at work collaborating on something, or she's doing her thing, mine's doing my thing, or if we're home taking care of our baby Penny. That's another whole collaboration. Now, with that particular pitch, you know, and this goes back to this idea of, you know, cutting through the noise, right? it is very hard to get your foot in the door of a major film studio. What my wife and I did when we heard that Crazy Rich Asians was coming out is we put together a pitch packet that is it's a fancy box, like a gift box, with 6 oranges, a showreel, some booklets about my history and my music, my influences, things like that. We sent it to the producers and the director, and they, you know, were sort of, they had their minds blown because we went to a lot of detail packaging this thing, making it foil stamped, making it look really, really glitzy as per the book, right? Crazy Rich Asians is all about opulence. So we wanted to present a physical product that looked opulent. And while doing that, I actually wrote a bunch of music, hired a small orchestra and big band and recorded. I know this gets a little
come weird. On, you say that so casually.
I know, but give me an orchestra, give me a big band, please. We did that. And I recorded a number of just new pieces that I wrote around the book. And we animated them to an extended video sequence where I took like quotes from the book, superimposed them over still imagery, just tried to bring the story to life through music and video. And, you know, as you mentioned, Jenny, video is a very powerful format for pushing music, right? Now, ultimately, the way this played out is that the director loved the big band song that I wrote, which was actually a modern reinvention of a 1930s Shanghai big band song called When Will You Return? And then the director decided that he wanted to open the movie with my big band number. And so they paid to have it re-recorded with a new singer. I rewrote the charts. And we, you know, the movie came out, the first 45 seconds that plays underneath the logos is my music. But there's actually a 3-minute long version of the song. They retitled the song, When Will You Return? And we can actually post the link to that YouTube video in the chat if people want to check it out. But it's kind of a fun thing to do. You know, Chinese big band, right? I mean, it was a blast to write and record. And actually, that was my first time writing for a big band. And, you know, to get that opportunity on a big summer movie was kind of there's a leap of faith on Warner Brothers' part, but it was, you know, I took advantage of it as best I could.
Well, and I just want to emphasize for everyone who's watching it, because Chris sort of breezed through this, and I, you know, put together this package, and it was very opulent, and I hired an orchestra, and I made this reel, and wrote music, and did arrangements, that people do not do this. You know, this is not something that comes in the sort of the dossier of how composers sort of move forward in their path. Chris is one of the most entrepreneurial, self-driven, imaginative people, and has the technical ability to execute on, you know, in the quality of the music, but also in the presentation of it. And that is a real rarity. And composers are so often reliant upon the partners of, you know, an ensemble, an orchestra. You want that partnership, but the ability to use technology to serve your promotional and performance needs, but also to be self-generative is really powerful, and it's unusual. So I just, you know, it may be kind of a typical day's work for you, but I just want everyone to appreciate how remarkable that is. I don't know if I know that the link was just popped into the chat. Do we want to watch it now, or should I keep moving on, David? Can't hear you, no?
Somebody muted? David, you're muted?
There's a link in the chat, you said?
Or there was going to be a link in the chat. I didn't know if you wanted to show a clip.
The only other...
I can post it.
Okay. Let me make you, give you the power.
When will you return, Jasmine Chen? Waiting for your return. That's how they retitled it. Okay, here we go. Y'all can be free to check this out on your own time if you want, or if you want to watch it now, go. I mean, actually, we should probably keep this moving, right?
Yeah,
it's a fun song. You know, give it a listen.
It's pretty fabulous. All right, so we'll let people enjoy it on their own home theater system, and let's pivot a little bit to Shiver the Sky. So you've written this monumental work. Described as an oratorio, but that means oratorio orchestra, full choir, solo vocalists. You saw a few of the clips from the rehearsals and the performances, the recording in London. And so Chris, you've conducted it, you've recorded it, and in a matter of days, it's going to be released worldwide. And it celebrates mankind's fascination with the universe and explores what's beyond our terrestrial lives. So tell us a little bit about the piece, about the, you've spoken a little bit in the intro, but also how it came to be, why this particular focal point and subject now, and also how it's going to be released in CD form and other forms, just to give people a sense of the creation process and also the sort of launch process. And I think also if you can speak a little bit about the crowdfunding model that you leveraged, I think that's really important as part of the creative ecosystem.
Sure. Well, to answer the middle question, it's going to be released in every single format you can possibly imagine starting Friday: CD, vinyl, streaming, download, everything. You know, the goal is to get it out there on as many different platforms as possible. To answer the question about how I started this project, it actually started from the video game world. And I say this because I wrote a theme for Civilization VI. It was a game that was very much about exploration. So what I wrote was a song called Sogno di Volare, which means the dream of flight. And I used words from Leonardo da Vinci about flight and his flying machines. And I set those to music. And the song became very popular in the gaming world. So my entrepreneurial brain said, okay, what can I do to take this and leverage it into success in another world? And it's a formula that's worked well for me in the past. And so I thought I'll do this again. And, you know, the real sort of turning point was when I realized, you know what, we're just going to take this track from Civilization VI and, you know, build 10 other tracks around it. And in essence, tell the story about mankind's fascination with flight from pioneers and visionaries like Leonardo da Vinci to telling stories from, you know, mythology like the Daedalus and Icarus myth, to going through the decades and addressing various, you know, scientists and pilots and writers and people who have actually discussed flight. And it's not just about, you know, the words of this famous pilot and the words of this famous astronaut and John F. Kennedy's speech on the moon landing, but it also goes deeper into the religious and philosophical implications of flight, right? So I talk, I use texts from, for example, Dante or Hildegard von Bingen. I use an excerpt from Copernicus's treatise on the heliocentric universe. And I use a text from Jules Verne. Like Jules Verne in 1865 published From the Earth to the Moon, right? And I grabbed an excerpt of that and I set that to music as well and recorded it with a children's choir. You know, all of these stories about the history of flight in my mind led us to this one amazing moment in, you know, 1969 when we actually put a man on the moon. And that was just possible because of, you know, centuries of innovations and science and study and you know, this pioneering spirit that drove us to achieve this amazing moment. And in my mind, this moment of landing a man on the moon, it was the last time the entire world was fixated on one event, watching the same thing in real time, in a positive way. I mean, I think there have been other negative events that have sort of, you know, captured the eyes of everyone around the world since then. But I can't think of another moment since then where it's just, we were all just captivated by how amazing we as a people have become. And that's the sort of moment that I really wanted to build towards on this album. So the last thing is, you had a point about crowdfunding. I did crowdfund this album. I actually turned to my fan base and I said, I need money, help me fund this album. And they came through. I actually raised about a pretty substantial amount of money. I won't say the exact amount, but it was quite enough to get me going here. And it was, it was important to do so because these albums cost hundreds of thousands of dollars to record, as you can imagine. And I, you know, that basically paid for it. But it was also a way for me to activate my fan base in a way. And what was great about this was that you know, it was another way to cut through the noise in a way. Like, we're always talking about how hard it is to launch music into this world these days and get attention on it, specifically with so many different things going on in the world these days. It's just hard to get people to pay attention when you have new music out there, right? But one of the ways that I was able to get a head start on starting the conversation about my upcoming work was 2 years ago, I raised a lot of money and set a new record for classical music crowdfunding. And that started the conversation early on with a lot of people. So any angle you can use to get people talking about your music is worth pursuing, I think. And this goes to your point, Jenny, about composers these days, I think, needing to broaden what they embrace. I think in the past, it could be, you know, I think we had this conversation in your office, like you could just be a composer, you write a, you know, commission for a symphony orchestra, and then after the piece gets performed, you walk out, and you know, wave, and you take a bow, and you shake hands with the conductor and the concertmaster, and you walk off, and that's kind of all you need to do. I don't think that's the way anymore. I think composers should think in terms of being entrepreneurs. I think they should take a page from the playbook of all those indie bands and aspiring singer-songwriters out there who are constantly on YouTube, doing live streams, talking about their music, trying to get people to sign up for their mailing list, you know, just being active on social media, connecting with fans, signing autographs after your concerts. I really think there needs to be a new engagement model in the classical music world that's more fan-friendly and less like behind a wall. And that's what I'm trying to do. And I'm hoping that, you know, this will help open up new markets for me.
You know, it's a point really resting upon, because it's, I mean, you've obviously seeded the ultimate sort of consumers and audience members, because you've made them part of the process. They, before the work was created or before it was recorded, you had people who wished you well and were invested in this ultimate outcome. So they were your partners, whether, you know, $10 or $1,000, however people supported you. And, you know, when you've been part of something, and that's something that is very, that feels very authentic to this moment, we're in this sort of collective action, the advocacy, the awareness of the value of strength of numbers, and the pride of shared joy, especially as an antidote to so many of the weighty issues that continue to weigh on us. I think it's a very exciting and positive dimension. So I know people around the world are excited to hear it. And, you know, speaking of your fan base, I have seen a member of your fan base appear in some of our Zoom videos in the form of your daughter, Penny, who is adorable. And she's a frequent presence in your work and life as it is. And, you know, I know that you're a very... You're deeply committed to your family, and there's a sense of seamlessness between life and work. And so I was wondering, tell us very briefly before we jump to our questions, what is a day like between writing, producing, and parenting for you and your wife?
Oh man, it's like 80% parenting, let me tell you. I mean, Penny is 2 years, 3 months-ish now, almost 4 months. And, you know, she's a real joy, but oh my goodness, it's a lot of work. And in a way, we are more focused as adults now. You know, we have to, you know, stick to a certain schedule now that we didn't have imposed on our lives before. You know, we are very focused on making sure she has the best in life. I mean, it really does reinvent you as a person, right? You also find ways to be more disciplined on those few hours a day that you have to actually do work, and you just try to get stuff done, and there isn't this like, oh, I'm going to click on Facebook for 10 minutes while this file loads up, you know, or something like that. It's just, you just focus in and do what you need to do as fast as you can and efficiently and effectively as you can. I mean, for me, you know, being a father is, it also awoke a bit of a sense of wanting to use my music to do good in the world. I don't know how else to put that, but it's given my music an added dimension of urgency in that I feel that I do need to build upon this catalog of works that perhaps portrays the idealized world that we all want to live in, you know, or reflects on the successes that we've had as a species in the past as a model for and a reminder for what we can do as a people in the future. I think there's a lot of music that's cranked out there that doesn't necessarily have a purpose behind it, which is totally fine. There's a lot of classical music out there that just simply exists to be music, which is a wonderful thing as well. Lately, I've been very interested in the subtexts of my pieces and what they can do to further the dialogue of you know, the refinement and advancement of civilization and humanity. I mean, in some small way, if To Shiver the Sky can inspire someone to be a visionary leader like Amelia Earhart or John F. Kennedy, I think that would be a wonderful thing. Music has that ability, I think, to inspire people. So we should take that seriously. And I think that's what I'm trying to do with this album and the future albums that we've also talked about, Jenny. I do want to make a statement that you know, we can be a better version of ourselves, especially in moments like these when we're pretty down about the world around us.
Yeah, I think that's a profound thing to pivot from. And I think about the evolution of the museum as well, that people discover a great deal about themselves and aspire to greater heights and to explore more deeply when art and history are synthesized in fresh ways. In a way, it animates ideas, and we can learn so much through how artists interpret key moments in their lives and history, and kind of pivot us to digging perhaps a little bit more deeply. I know that was very formative for me as a composer, listening to the music of Aaron Copland and understanding a bit more about American history and geography and folk music and Emerson, Lake and Palmer. So you just sort of never know where music of composers and work will lead you. Well, look, I see that there are people using through the chat function, and I wonder if David or Penny would like us to answer.
Sure. Do you want me to read some of them out loud?
Sure. Sure. Because okay. You've probably seen them coming in. I haven't been scanning.
Yeah. Sure. For the lucky people that fly, like my husband, not my husband, the person's husband. Being a pilot and flying is a spiritual experience. How do we use your music? Please explain the cost and royalties to use your music. Thank you.
Well, I would love if you use my music. I would get in serious trouble if I just said, oh, use my music. I think this needs, you know, any sort of formal requests for any sort of like commercial usage of my music does have to go through my manager, who will then direct you to my record label and my publishers and, you know, that there are channels that unfortunately need to be gone through. However, I mean, if you just want to play your music in my music in the background while you're flying or doing things for private use, I would love that. Just do it. I mean, sometimes I get a lot of emails like, how do we use your music? Can we get permission to use your music for, you know, like our wedding, for example, which is always very touching to me. I sort of say, you know, like, as long as you're not like, you know, selling videos of your wedding or something like that, it's probably fine just to play it. I mean, I'm not precious about, you know, like shutting down unauthorized uses of my music. I want my music to be out there as much as possible. And if it generates some income for some people, great. But I don't ever want to say no to anyone using my music, unless it's for obviously, you know, unflattering or not good usages. But generally speaking, I want people to use my music as much as possible.
At the end of our discussion, we'll put up your website and we'll also follow up an email to everybody. Would they be able to find your representation through your website? Okay, terrific.
Yeah, it's all on the contact page of my website.
Great. Let's see. Chris, can you talk about the visual elements of the music, the notations forming constellations, or have I made up that from an earlier conversation, and I have the PDF that you sent me. Would this be a good time to share that?
Yeah, share that. Share okay. A couple of the pages that show the constellations.
Yeah, let me pull that up.
I'll talk you all through this as we're going through it. So as I had mentioned before, One of the movements of Shiver the Sky is the setting of Nicholas Copernicus's De Revolutionum, if you have the title in front of you, it's a mouthful, De Revolutionibus Orbi et Coelestium, on the revolutions of the celestial spheres. It is a the treatise that really first posited for the world the sun was the center of the universe and not the earth, right? So it's a very definitive work pushing forward the heliocentric theory of the universe. So that was important for me to include into Shiver the Sky. Now, I thought a fun thing to do for this particular movement would be to try to find a way to actually incorporate constellations into the score itself. So what you're seeing on the screen here is one of the score pages. A lot of the note heads themselves, if you were to draw lines between them, you'll see that they actually form constellations. So what you're looking at now is the Pegasus constellation. And if you were to scroll down, David, you'll see there's the toucan constellation there. And I actually had an illustrator draw a toucan over it on the score. So Boothie and Hawks, Jenny's former company, will be publishing this with the constellations in the score. Here we have Draco the dragon and Muska the fly. And you know, these are the actual constellations, the shapes of the constellations, you know, that you see in the sky. I just had to find a clever way to work them into the score by having various instruments play certain notes on certain beats so that we could connect all the lines and draw these constellations out. There's the peacock. And yeah, there is, what's that? The swan, Cygnus the swan. Valance the flying fish is down there. What else? Aquila the eagle. Unfortunately, I put that one in upside down. I didn't realize I made that mistake until after I wrote the piece. And then my illustrator said, hey, you realize you actually put the constellation in upside down. This last one is Phoenix. I didn't have a illustration done for this one because it's too large of a constellation. It spans the entire page. But all of these constellations share something in common. They're all related to flight. They're all animals with wings, right? So that was just a fun little thing that I thought, I can do this. Why not throw it in there? It's not going to hurt. It makes sense musically. And to go back to this whole discussion about entrepreneurship, honestly, this is the sort of thing that publishers will want to make social media posts about. It's the sort of thing that might go viral if I put together a nice looking video. You know, it's another marketing hook. And, you know, I would love to see, for example, some social media thing that's like, whoa, look at this sheet music with the constellations written into the note heads. You know, maybe that's the sort of thing that will get a few more eyeballs looking at my music. But any angle, any hook I can find to create a marketing moment out of, I think is a useful thing to put in. And in essence, this entire album is all marketing hooks. I mean, each of the movements is the words of a famous inventor or scientist or pilot or something like that. There are anniversaries for all of these events. Some of them you will want to acknowledge, some you may not want to acknowledge. I have a movement dedicated to the development of the atomic bomb. And as we know, just last week was the anniversary, the 75th anniversary of the bombs being dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. So that is not an appropriate moment to try to sell an album with, of course. But, you know, there are countless, you know, events, I think, that can be created around different movements of this album. Anniversaries, just anything, right? And so in a way, I was handing over a bundle of music with a bunch of built-in Instagram posts attached to it, you know, just to give people a way to market it.
Next question is, you bring in many diverse sources to your music. What led you to discover these sources? How did you decide to utilize them? Leonardo's writings in Sogno de Volare, the Torah in Calling All Dawns, Swahili in Baba Yetu, etc.
There is a lot of Wikipedia and online research, I think, that goes into my music. Even before I start writing, there's a lot of research that has to go into it. I mean, first thing I had to do was acquaint myself with the history of flight and who are the key players, what are the stories we want to tell. And this is one of these moments where I was able to turn to my Kickstarter community that we talked about, Jenny, and involve them. And early on, I said, look, I know I want to start with this and I want to end with this, but I don't know what's going to go on in the middle. So give me your ideas. And I had all sorts of ideas sent in from my fans. And this creates audience engagement for me, of course. It gives me a way to, you know, connect with people. But also it gave me a way to really just learn from different people's perspectives about what the history of flight was all about. So to give you an example, I heard from some aerospace engineers who wrote to me and said, hey, I spent all my, you know, college years studying engineering and astronautics because I wanted to build satellites and help connect the world. But in the back of my mind, every time I'm developing one of these new technologies, I know that there's a chance that the military might use it for military purposes, right? And that's just sort of a moral dilemma that I've had to deal with in my professional life. And so I thought, wow, I've never actually thought about this before. Let's address this on the album. And so there is a movement based around the words of Ferdinand von Zeppelin, where Zeppelin, sung by this tenor, Penne Pati is his name, an amazing tenor, he talks about how he's invented this airship, and it's his goal is to use it for peaceful commerce and trade and an interchange of scientific ideas and all these wonderful positive things. But then 50 years later, it's used to drop bombs on London, right? So it's, you know, it's all these stories about flight were presented to me partially by crowdsourcing, and I synthesized as many of them as I could. And that became the basis for the story that I wanted to tell. And I think there was a sub question about languages here. I do use a lot of non-traditional languages in my works. There's multiple reasons for that. I mean, a lot of the stories that I want to tell are global stories. The history of flight is a global story. It involved the participation of many different people across many nations. I wanted to keep it authentic and in their voices by using their languages, right? But there's also a part of me that just wants to get away from the choral canon being sung entirely in Latin and English. I think there are a lot of great languages out there. Sure, some of them present really challenging pronunciation problems, but what I found is there's just a lot of great phonetic sounds out there in different languages, a lot of great poetry that can be explored in the choral canon. And I sort of took it upon myself to expand the breadth of what the choral canon is comprised of linguistically.
And actually, could I pipe in there just for a moment? Our original partner, and still our existing partner, but the original partner for the performance was always the U.S. Air Force Band with the Singing Sergeants and also the Choral Arts Society of Washington, D.C. And I'm not sure how many people are aware, but the Singing Sergeants actually sing the national anthems of visitors, diplomats from other countries, heads of state. And so as part of their service to the United States, they learn the pronunciations, the languages, the songs, the music of visitors from other countries. And when I learned that coming to Washington, not only are they some of the most fabulous and well-trained musicians in the country, but then also adopting this sort of cultural diplomacy and welcoming, it's a really touching part of their program. And we have a program at Washington Performing Arts called the Embassy Adoption Program, which connects fifth and sixth grade classrooms with embassies and territorial representatives from around the world. And kids have the opportunity to learn the songs of the countries that they're partnered with. And they do that with the partnership of the Singing Sergeants and the US Air Force Band. So it's a very special Washington, DC thing that happens with us, with the embassies. And I love the fact that that Chris was working with so many different languages through this piece. It was a beautiful amplification of something that exists actually quite organically with one of our partners.
I didn't know that. That's amazing. And it makes perfect
cool.
sense.
Very cool.
Yeah, that's super cool.
Military bands would do justice to your music. They're hugely accomplished musicians. Would this be a problem? Please explain if there is a moral dilemma.
There is. I mean, what I've discovered is, the band are very, very, very good musicians and amazing ensembles. I mean, you know, history is what it is, right? And I don't think that there's no there's no judgment here. I don't think there's, I don't personally think that there's a conflict or a friction per se.
What is your opinion of 12-tone music? Have you incorporated this genre into your compositions with its almost formulaic approach? It could lend itself to visual connections like the constellations, but it does not please the ear as much as it challenges the mind, right?
Yes, yes. I am not, I have addressed 12-tone music in my music. A lot of what I do is there's a lot of acknowledgement of trends of contemporary classical music without making my pieces about those particular trends. So serial music, minimalism, spectralism, you know, all of these things, they, I embrace them. I find ways to incorporate them into my music, elements of them, in the same way that I incorporate elements of jazz or musical theater or rock. But they're not, I don't build my music around them. I think it's nice to have a little nod to 12-tone music here and there. Maybe I'll play something in retrograde as a nod to, you know, certain processes around 12-tone music. But I am very much about writing music that is enjoyable to as wide a swath of people as possible, and music that stands up on its own, whether you're studying a score or just listening to it in the background or listening to it in concert or playing a video game and my music comes on. I just want it to be as approachable as possible to as many different people as possible while having the integrity of compositional craftsmanship such that it can withstand the scrutiny of all the toughest critics out there. That's my goal, to write music that has mass appeal, yet is well written enough that people don't say, oh, he's just, you know, a hack or whatever. That's what I like to do.
You know, I think too that it goes back to that essential question of toolkit, that there are certain things that you need in order to express a special or evoke the images and the sentiment that is at the root of your work. And in some cases, the grit and the stridency of 12-tone music can be exactly what you need for that particular moment, a point of expression, but it's not necessarily the system around which you build or through which you anchor your music. So that sense of being able to draw upon that whole arsenal of sound is really powerful.
Yeah, it's a tool. Yeah, you're absolutely right. It's a tool in the toolbox that doesn't get used a ton, but it's there and I know how it works in case I ever need to use it.
We probably have time for about two more questions. Please talk about the title, To Shiver the Sky.
Ah, okay. That comes from a Rudyard Kipling poem. And the whole quote goes, we build it a tower to shiver the sky and tear the stars apart. And what I love about this poem is not only does it have this fantastic quote in it, I just put it in the chat window, by the way, in case you want to read it. Not only is to shiver the sky just a fantastically evocative phrase, and it just, you just imagine like rocket thrusters vibrating the air molecules around you, right? This whole poem is about art. And much of the philosophizing that goes on behind the scenes that I let my Kickstarter backers see, you know, in being part of the creative process is, you know, just the theorizing behind what a piece of work is and how I want to address it. And what is art? What is entertainment? You know, how do these coexist? What I love about this poem is it's a story about how the devil is basically challenging our perceptions of what is art, you know? And there was perhaps a bit of a nod to, you know, this lifelong debate that I've had about, you know, like where are we, you know, how much of what we create is art versus entertainment, especially how much of what I create, like how much of it is pure art? How much of it is just appeasing my fan base? How do I synthesize the two? So this poem just happened to have that great line in it, but it also is reflective of just sort of my own creative headspace, I suppose.
Do you associate yourself with the world of John Williams or Ennio Morricone?
Morricone, two of my heroes. So well spotted. I mean, I love them both. They're just amazing composers. And may Maestro Morricone rest in peace. He passed away about a month ago. I think those are two great examples of contemporary composers who write very accessible music, but well crafted, very, very well crafted, such that no one would challenge whether they knew what they were doing. And I hold both of them up as role models, especially since they both emphasize, in my mind, one of the most important, aspects of music, and that is melody. I am still very much a big time proponent of great melodies. I think that's what separates the pieces that, you know, last for decades and become a part of the canon, as opposed to the ones that just become sort of footnotes or, you know, maybe find a performance here and there. I think if you can write a great tune, you can work in any medium. Anyone will embrace you somewhere, right? And that's been my lifetime focus, putting out music that has great melodies in it. And I think John Williams and Ennio Morricone are two of my heroes in that regard.
I think one more question. Someone from the gaming world said that that your music should be the anthem of humanity. Are there others, crossover industries or areas where classical or orchestral music can reach new audiences?
I think that these days, gaming is probably the best form of multimedia for putting orchestral music in front of audience members. I think the film and TV industries are moving away from this sort of rich orchestral sound that we had, you know, with composers like Morricone and John Williams. It's become much more sound design based, ambient. You don't hear melodies much in films these days. It's kind of an archaic sort of sound for the film and TV business. Video games, however, are a different story, because video games are very, they like to transport you to another time and place. I mean, so many of them are based around fantasy properties and fictional universes, right? That's where orchestral scoring is still thriving these days. And I think that's where we see a lot of symphony orchestras developing innovative concerts around video game soundtracks. For a lot of the people who come to these concerts, their first time actually going to hear a symphony orchestra live, and that becomes a hook to maybe come back and see more programming. But it's incumbent upon the orchestras at that point to find some way to bridge the gap between Final Fantasy and, you know, Beethoven 7th, right? Like, you gotta find a way to keep people coming back to the concert hall. I sort of hope that my music can be a mini sort of gateway from one world to the other. That's what I'm trying to do. That's why, you know, it was great to work with Jenny and WPA on events like this, that sort of have this hybrid crossover effect between these two different worlds. And I sort of think that is the way, one of the avenues, the most prominent avenues, that we can introduce a generation of new music fans to classical music through things like game scores.
Well, everybody, thank you so much for joining us. Christopher and Jenny, thank you so much
thank
for
you.
Your time. And
thank you.
I could just tell from the comments on this call that people are very excited about this album, and we're really looking forward to seeing it. Let me, while we're closing out, I'll show this screen. And then we'll also follow this up in an email. But here is Christopher's website and also Washington Performing Arts, as well as the museum's website. And, we are really pleased that you could all join us. And Jenny, I don't know if you have any final comments.
I appreciate that we've had so many people join today. I know how busy everyone's day is, and yet the chance to get a little bit more deeply inside a work and get to know an interesting and lovely and talented composer, and perhaps to discover other works and to follow and support is really, it's a great opportunity. I'm so glad that the museum, David and Penny, that you've masterminded this this event, and that your interest has endured through all of the different iterations of To Shiver the Sky. It really takes a village and community of people to believe in this, and I think this work is emblematic of exactly that, and the best of our collaboration across institutions, individuals, communities. So please buy the album. Please join us on August 29th, 7 o'clock Eastern time, for another deep dive into the work. And thank you. Thank you for your support of these great cultural institutions and artists.
Yeah, thank you. I'll just, you know, follow up on that. Say thank you so much for, you know, your being a part of this and joining today and allowing me to share some of my creative process with you.
All right. Have a terrific rest of the week, and we hope to see you all soon. Thank you.
Take care, everyone. Bye-bye.